Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Alex Kendrick Show, episode 6. Get your tickets. Oh, God, I hear crazy delay. I deliver 702-498-4488. No taxes or fees. A third at Eagle Hall with Traders. Farewell tour, $13, all ages. May 10th, Eagle Hall. With... I don't know. It went away. I'm going to try this again. Last try, otherwise I'm going to totally give up, but I'm trying to celebrate May 3rd. May 15th at Adrenaline Bar with Evergrey, Seven Kingdoms, Nita, Cyndia, $17, shows 21+. May 19th at Adrenaline Bar with Shining, Revenge, Wolfhammer, $12, shows 21+. May 20th at Brooklyn Bowl with Testament, Sepultura, and Prong, $28, shows 18+. May 26th at Adrenaline Bar with Xandria, Cobra, and the Lotus, Once Human, $12, shows 21+. May 31st at Backstage Bar and Billiards with Twisted, GMO, Ski, Young Wicked, Gorilla Voltage, $30 each, shows 21+. June 3rd at Downtown Event Center with Three Doors Down, Hell Yeah, Asking Alexandria, Pop Evil, 10 Years, Devour the Day, Otherwise, and More, $99, all ages. June 6th at Eagle Hall with Kublai Khan and Currents, $13 each, all ages. June 10th at the Dive Bar with Dead Kennedys and Infirmities, $20 each, 21+. June 17th at the Church with Big D and the Kids Table, Left Alone, the Doped Up Dollies, $14 each, all ages. June 23rd at the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino with Warped Tour, 50+ bands, Hatebreed, Stick to Your Guns, Skylar, Knocked Loose, Fit for a King, Being as an Ocean, After the Burial, Sworn In, Guar, Carnifex, Amura, The Casey Strain, and tons more, $38 all ages. June 25th at Brooklyn Bowl with Streetlight Manifesto and more, $31, shows 18+. July 8th at Downtown Event Center with Rise Against Deftones, Thrice, Frank Lero, and The Patience, $42 all ages. July 15th at Downtown Event Center with Goo Goo Dolls, $31. July 23rd at Hard Rock Hotel, The Pool with Less Than Jake, $23 all ages. July 17th at Hard Rock Hotel Pool with Take You Back Sunday, Every Time I Die, Modern Chemistry, $29 all ages. August 25th with Downtown Event Center with Rancid Dropkick Murphys, $42 all ages. August 29th at Brooklyn Bowl with Simple Plan, Set It Off, Patent Pending, $35 all ages. September 15th at Backstage Bar Billiards with Hake, a 10th anniversary tour at Sithu A, $20 each, shows 21+. September 29th at Downtown Event Center with Sublime with Rome, The Offspring, $25 all ages. October 19th at Fremont Country Club with KMFDM, Ogur, Lord of the Lost, $28, shows 21+. Follow me on Instagram at The Jewish King. Follow me on my Instagram at JK Productions LV. Like my show and concert page, JK Productions. All right. And that's how I chose to start the show this week, because it is May 3rd after all. What's going on, guys? We have an awesome lineup of folks today. Some friends of mine that I've made over the years from touring. First off, we have Frank Finelli, who started a awesome fund called For the Nomads. It is a touring crew relief aid, you know, for those who rely on tours, productions of whatever caliber, to pay bills and do this full time. He has a fund for that that's reached nearly, I want to say, $34,000 last time I checked, which is incredible. We have him up. All of the donations made to the stream today via, if you're watching on Facebook or Twitch. If you're watching on Facebook, head over to my Twitch, twitch.tv/TheAlexKendrick. You'll notice a donate button right off the bat. 100% of donations during the live stream will go straight to For the Nomads, which is freaking awesome, and I'm hoping we can rack some bucks up for that. It's an awesome cause for some awesome people. We have Matt McGatchy, a good friend of mine who I've toured with. He is the singer of a band called Cryptopsy and the host of the Vox and Hops podcast. Awesome guy. We're going to have some awesome talks, and I'm sure that we'll have a little beer talk somewhere in there. We have my buddy DJ, aka Daniel Danoon. He's the monitor engineer and guitar tech for Killswitch Engage, and the monitor engineer for, let's check these notes, Okga. Oh no, Okay Go. Yeah, that's what I meant. We have Alex Marquides. I always freaking forget. Sorry, Holmes. I love you, and you're horny. The front of house engineer for Periphery, Killswitch Engage, Suicidal Tendencies. I'm sure there's many, many more in there. We have him on. great dude. We're going to talk some audio, blah, 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 blah. I'm pretty sure we're all taking major losses due to this coronavirus, COVID-19, et cetera, that we will get into. We have the man himself, Sam Kirby, another fellow audio engineer. He mixes artists like Atreyu, Mod Sun, and Hail the Sun. The list goes on. We've toured together throughout the years as well. So without further ado, I think we'll go ahead and get everyone on. As of this week, I haven't really been doing much of anything. Things are starting to open back up where I live, but I'm definitely going to stay home. And just so I get this out of the way, shout out, Mom, because I know you're watching. Hello. Do-do-do-do. Howdy, howdy, howdy. What's going on, guys?
Hey,
yo. What's up, what's up?
How we doing? Who are we missing? We're missing Sam and we're missing DJ. We got Hi, Sam. How's it going? What's going Sam, on, man?
You with the mustache. How you doing, brother?
You know, had to get rid of the beard this time.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, I like the mustache on you. It's a good look.
Well, you know, this... CDC said, correct. Had to get rid of it. Had to be safe.
I couldn't really hear there for a second. Boom, there he is. How's it going?
Hello.
Welcome. Okay, so I've already kind of done some introductions, but I'll go ahead and do them with you guys here. I'm going to go around and start. Everyone, tell the world who you are and what you do. We'll start with you, Frank.
This is very, very scary that I'm telling the entire world.
Well, hopefully the entire world is listening. I don't know. Probably not. But well, we can hope.
A lot of pressure. There's a lot of pressure to start off that way. I am a tour manager, merchandiser, lighting guy, VIP coordinator, production manager, you name it. I've been touring for 14 years, and I just started a fundraiser around 6 weeks ago called For the Nomads, which is raising money for the crew members of our music industry that are out of work right now.
Which is awesome, by the way. Congratulations on the success with that. It looks like it's going amazing.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Another reminder to anyone watching right now, 100% of donations from the stream will go straight to For the Nomads.
Yes.
keep going around the circle here. Matt, why don't you tell the pseudo world about yourself?
What's up, everyone? I'm Matt, the vocalist of Cryptopsy. I'm also the host of the Vox and Hops podcast. Vox and Hops is an interview-based podcast where I sit down with fellow metal musicians to talk about their lives, music, and of course, craft beer, which I love very, very, very much. Right now I'm drinking Mabedosity's, it's a light lager, 4%, starting off nice and easy because it's the beginning of the, you know, the live stream. So I'll work my way up to deeper stuff. So shout out to Mabedosity for sending me some brews in these crazy times so I can do my interviews from home. That's I want to awesome. Say to Frank, For the Nomads, such a great initiative, and I've been talking about it on the podcast nonstop that a lot of people think about the artist suffering, but a lot of people have forgotten the crew, and none of these shows happen if the crew's not there. So my very, very great initiative, and everyone hit that donate button, and let's get some money to these crew members tonight.
Hey, thank you very much, man. I appreciate that. I've been a fan of Cryptopsy for a long time.
Cool.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah, yeah. Everyone, again, feel free to donate. It's all going to For the Nomads. We'll move on to Miss my fellow Alex. Want to
hey,
tell
man.
The world about yourself and what you do out there on the road?
Yeah, man. I'm front of house and PM for Periphery, Killswitch Engage, and Suicidal Tendencies. Been on the road for about 13 years. I've done guitar tech as well, some merch here and there, and TMing.
And very nice. Yeah. A common occurrence I see with a lot of crew members is it's very vital to kind of act as a multi-tool.
Yeah. Everybody's kind of doing 2 to 3 jobs everywhere we go. Yeah. So it keeps us busy, you know, makes the day go by a little bit faster.
Certainly. Brother DJ, do you want to tell everyone about yourself? What you do?
Hey, my name is DJ Danude. I'm on the other side of Alex's snake. I'm a guitar... guitar tech monitor engineer for Killswitch Engage, and I also do monitors for OKGo.
Very awesome. How long have you been in
with the treadmills?
Yes.
Tight.
That's awesome. How long have you been with those guys?
I've been with Killswitch for almost 2 years and OKGo for about three.
Very nice. And last but certainly not least, Sam, you want to tell everyone about your life? Oh, is he frozen?
I'm a front house tour manager. Uh-oh.
You kind of froze up. Maybe you just want to repeat. You're back now.
All right, cool. Front house engineer, tour manager. I've been a merch manager before, but I've kind of stepped away from that. Focused more on audio past couple of years. Recently, I've been working for Treyu, Mod Sun, handful of other bands in that world.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah, I know if it wasn't for tour, I don't think I would know any of you guys. So
That's true, yeah.
It's kind of crazy how the circle brings everyone together. It's kind of a small circle with a huge network of people.
Right.
Frank, when did you get into touring? You said 14 years ago. How did you kind of get into the game?
Yes. Yeah, so I wasn't always just a crew guy. I sang for a band from New York called The World We Knew. I started in 2004, and we were a metal band or metalcore or hardcore, whatever you want, back then. And then we did that for 9 years before it obviously just kind of ran its course and we saw the writing on the wall. And before we actually called it quits, I started kind of working for other bands because I saw an out into still touring, but also making a little bit of money here and there, not knowing that it would actually turn into a career for the, I mean, up until now, which is, that was 7 years ago, the band broke up. So for the past 7 years, I've only been doing crew work. But yeah, I started as a musician, sang in the band, did it with three records on three different record labels, toured all over the world, actually did it, like went in deep and made the transition.
Very awesome, man. It sounds like you came in with a pretty level head, and you came in, you know, from one side going straight to the other, you know, with knowing about, you know, playing and being on stage, and then knowing kind of what you needed and what kind of help you would need. So as a crew member, you know, you kind of knew how to, you know, I guess adapt to artists. Like, I don't know, I've noticed that, like, a lot of crew members, you know, aren't just crew members, like they also play instruments and jam, you know. Like Alex, DJ, Sam, do you guys jam?
For sure, yeah. I play, I started out playing drums, but I have gotten into guitars because it's just too loud. So I play guitar now all the time.
Oh, yeah. DJ?
Yeah, I used to play in bands years ago.
Yeah, I used to play in a bunch of bands throughout high school and even afterwards. I still play.
You're in a band right now. It's called Heavy Fucking.
Oh yeah, we have a crew band. Yeah.
And that's awesome.
I can play Baby Shark on the acoustic guitar.
I mean, what else do you really need?
Yeah, exactly.
If you put a video up right now of just that on YouTube, you'll make more money than you'll ever do as a crew member, I'm sure. That's like the most popular kid song on the planet.
Yeah, my son loves it. That's the only reason I don't want to play that stupid song.
I think you should live stream you playing that to tracks like every other day.
If we could just not have this conversation at all and it's just you playing the song.
Yeah, can you actually get your guitar right now?
We might actually make money for the nomads right now.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know, maybe later.
All right.
Yeah. Okay. Well, just know the offer stands. You know, it's funny enough. Mike Caputo, Rings of Saturn's drummer, does like a death metal thing to Baby Shark, and he's got like a video to it on YouTube and shit, where he's like just doing crazy blast beats over it. And
yeah,
I gotta watch.
Absurd. So let's go back to For the Nomads for a second, because that it seems to have gotten a pretty substantial amount of success, in my opinion, from the get-go. Was this something that, you know, like how long into it did it take you of thinking to kind of launch this kind of thing, Frank?
It was okay. So I assistant tour manage Black Belt Brides and do their lights. So they were getting ready to do their like comeback, I guess you want to call it. They took off. I was tour managing Andy's solo project for that whole general time frame. And they kicked out the one guy that they had like a big problem with, which is why they like didn't tour as much. And everything mellowed out really big. And they got together. They wanted to play again and wrote some songs, announced some. And we were going to do a 4-month world tour, basically. And we did one show in Mexico City before this all fell to shit. And got a call. So we did Mexico City. I flew home. Show was insane. They were really high on how well it did. It did like people sold out. It was like, oh, we're going to come back. This is going to be, yeah, like this is the way to do it. So they were really stoked on it. We were really excited, all of us, our whole crew, to leave and get ready for the tour because it was, America and Canada, Australia, New Zealand, all of you. It doesn't matter. But anyway, got a call literally the day I was supposed to get on the plane to start pre-production for a second time. And basically just said, hey, Live Nation pulled the plug on everything we're doing for the next X amount of months. And I said, well, yeah, that I saw that coming. I saw the writing on the wall, but I didn't want to believe it. And I sat there for literally one day, jumped in the shower one morning, and this is a plug, but it makes sense for what we're talking about. I thought if I made another one of these Merch Daddy t-shirts.
Oh, dude.
Yeah.
Because I had, so the whole deal was I made a different version of this on Warped Tour 2000, whatever the last one was when I was on the tour, just for my own pockets. Like I wanted to sell a bunch of stupid shirts with a funny slogan and my face on it or whatever it was. And they sold like that. And I didn't put them online. I sold over 130 of them like right away on the tour. Just come find me. Didn't put them up in a booth or whatever. So I said, all right, well, I know I'm off for the next 4 months. Maybe if I just make another version of that, I could sell a bunch of them and I could pay my bills for the next couple months. Because at that time, we didn't know how severe everything was going to be. We just thought like, all right, I could pay I'll pay my rent.
Kind of expecting for the worst.
Exactly. I'll pay my rent for the next 2 months. Everything's fine. And then I sat there in the shower. I'm just doing my thing. I'm like, well, maybe if I get other people involved and we can actually like sell a lot of them, like 130 is a lot of shirts, but it's not sustainable for like a lot of people. And I just, the more I thought about it, I was like, well, all I've ever done and my entire crew is now out of work. And not to mention if this goes for everybody, because a lot of my friends are on bigger tours and work for bigger bands, obviously Live Nation is going to pull shit. And then obviously trickle effect where the smaller tours were getting canceled also, but that was besides the point. I thought, well, I can help my crew members also if I do this shirt. And then so on, so forth from there. Kind of just blossom into, if we make it good enough, it could probably work on a grander scale. But we started early we started really, really early. Like the day after they announced that all the tours were canned, we started right away. And I'm seeing a lot of stuff now coming out, you know, the past couple weeks, maybe 2 weeks or whatever, where people are trying to do this thing, which is great. I'm not like trying to fucking monopolize the whole crew fund effort or whatever. But I want to say that we were one of the first. Obviously, Music Cares is already there. Live Nation didn't have the plan yet, but they're a huge corporation, so they can branch out to whoever they want. So it was Music Cares and us right away jumping. And we raised like $13,000 in the very first day. Yeah.
Wow.
That's
sick.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's crazy. That's very successful in my opinion.
I'm super curious if a lot of these, the first day, especially the money come from fans or is it coming from artists trying to help out the crews?
So, a lot of artists have not gotten involved. And I don't want to say that like it's a dig at them because it's not. We started with an idea of I have a lot of friends in the music industry in general, regardless of what they do, regardless of the job they have or if they're a musician, not a musician. It doesn't matter. We've all been doing it enough time to where we know a lot of people in our position now that is out of work. If I just give it to everybody and say, hey, spread it around, and if you need some help, because I'm sure you will, just tell us what tour you got canceled, give us the proof of it, and spread it around. And it got thousands of spreads right away, because everybody's like, holy shit. The initial impact is, okay, well, my tour got canceled. How long is this going to go? Holy shit, I just lost a lot of money in the grand scheme of things. So everybody just thought, well, if I can get on this ball, I could potentially get a little bit of money too. So it just spread. Some band members retweeted and whatnot early, but most of the time it was just fans right away or friends of the crew members that were posting about it saying that, hey, I'm probably going to get help from this. Spread it around if you can.
That's always one of the best, you know, ways to spread something like that. It's just word of mouth, and like it's just all positivity, and there's no force, you know, of like or amplification that you have to do it. You know, it's just helping those people around you, and you know, it seems that it's, I don't know, it seems it's going just like really well. What's it at now? Almost 35 or 34?
So I did a 8-hour live stream telethon yesterday with 8 different music industry veterans, I guess, if you call it, you want to call it. We had Kevin Lyman from the founder of Warped Tour on. We had one of my absolute best friends, Tim from Fit for an Autopsy. We had Josh, who used to play Emotionless White. We had Trevor from Black Dahlia Murder. We had a bunch of people. And we raised the goal up to, I think we hit 30, I think we're at 35.7 right now.
That's amazing.
Yeah. It's just one of those things, like Matt, correct? Matt said,
yes.
He wanted to know if bands got involved. There has been bands that have gotten involved, but I never started reaching out to bands because they're in a shitty position as well. And it's one of those situations where I want to use their outreach, but they're all going to help themselves. So it's hard to, it's like a double-edged sword. It's like, yo, I work for you. I would love for you to help me, or I've worked for you in the past. I'd love you to help me, but oh yeah, you probably just lost like $100,000 as well, or you know what I mean? So it's hard. There's different ideas that we have to keep this going. We'll tie artists into it, and we're gonna launch that sometime this week. We've already been planning it for the past couple of days. It got a little hazy yesterday because I was doing the telethon thing, so I like stopped. But we're starting payouts today and throughout this week for the first round, and I'll get that when we talk further, but round two starts technically right now or tomorrow for the remainder of May for new applicants that can sign in. And we're gonna tie in some artists in a specific way that we just haven't announced yet, hopefully anyway.
That's awesome to kind of breach that weird kind of gap that doesn't really exist but does, you know.
Well, you're all a part of the family. Any crew member I've ever had out on the road with me is a part of my family for life, you know? So
yeah, totally.
At least we can sell shirts on our side. We have, you know, hypothetically a warehouse of overstock tour merch that we can sell on Big Cartel, and that gives us a little bit of help right now. But you guys on the road that are supposed to be on the road don't really have stuff to sell, so it's hard for you guys to make an income right now.
Yeah, it's really scary, because I was thinking of the idea in general. I brought it to my roommate, and because she was the first, she was the only one in the house. We were there alone, and I got out of the shower, and I was just like, is this a crazy idea? I was like, does this make sense to you? And we've actually been doing it, like thinking of ideas as we go. We didn't just structure an entire on that first day. I'm going to take a crazy picture with me in a ski mask selling black market fucking toilet paper items and whatnot, make crazy tour dates, which are on the back of the t-shirt, and they say really ridiculous things pertaining to a quarantine and a lockdown and us obviously having to stay home, put it on a shirt. It should be funny enough to sell 100, 200 of them, whatever. Who knows? I don't know. And what was I getting with this? Oh, so it's scary. But while I was thinking about it, I said, I have a savings right now. It's not so much about me, but the 21-year-old version of me was broke, like really broke. Like the band I was in, we'd do a tour. I'd maybe pay my rent for that month. And then if we didn't tour again, like really soon, it was all downhill. So I'm thinking of those crew members that maybe aren't in their 30s, like me, having a small savings or whatever. but it's the amount of time that this takes that we don't understand yet. We just don't know when this is going to get back to normal. So if we can give a little relief, whether it's to 100 people, 200 people, all that gave us the proof that they had their careers kind of just shut down at the moment, we could probably help them pay for their groceries for a couple of weeks. Because if we just split it between 10 people, we're all making a lot of fucking money. But if you use it as a team and you get hundreds of people on board that need the help, we can easily help enough people with the little things that still cost a lot of money in the grand scheme of how much time this is going to take.
Yeah, totally. I guess just because this will be kind of like a 2-for-1 for Alex and DJ, how has this hit like the Killswitch camp? Were you guys out at the time? Or?
Yeah, we were in, I don't know where the day off was, but we ended up in Pittsburgh, and you know, they were like, they posted about Live Nation like canning all the tours and stuff, and it's like crazy. You were talking about like how long is this gonna last? Like, me and DJ were looking at each other and we're like, fuck, let's prep for the Australia tour, which actually we were supposed to leave for like 5 days ago. We're like, we'll be back to normal in like no time, you know.
Yeah.
So we like literally prepped all the gear at the warehouse, at the Killswitch warehouse in Rhode Island. And we were like, all right, man, we'll see you guys in a month. It's like, now I feel like I've totally changed my perspective on when really it's all going to come back. I know, you know, some of the US, European countries want to like start phasing in live events, and like the whole drive-in concert approach thing that everybody's doing now, that's cool. I think that's a cool idea to get people at least to go to live music, you know, streaming to like FM and like, you know, listening in your car. Mm-hmm. I think that's pretty sweet. But as far as like, when we're going to get to like bigger shows, I think club shows are going to come back before arena shows for sure.
Yeah. But yeah.
Even then, I think Live Nation is going to be super cautious. They're obviously losing money, but like, it's just like, you know, who knows when, I don't even know. Right now at this point, I'm just like, whatever. Like, you can't bank on the fact that, oh yeah, maybe in the fall, but like really like maybe the second wave will happen. And then we're going to be fucked even further until like the following spring, you know, which is right. Basically now, but a year from now. So, I mean, I can't even imagine. Like, it's crazy. Like, me and all of us thought on the bus, you know, we were like, you know, they were talking to their management. And we were like, fuck, you know, like, all right, maybe Australia can happen. Then, you know, Iron Maiden announced that they were canceling the tour. So obviously, we're not going either. So we're just like, fuck, man. So now I don't even know what's gonna happen. I mean, there, you know, it got rescheduled. We got an email or something for like later this year, but like at this point, I'm just like, I don't even think it's gonna happen at that point, which sucks. Like, obviously,
yeah,
back to music, but none of us can even do anything. I know some like audio companies in my area have been doing live streaming for like bands or whatever. You know, they can go in and like do like a live stream and stuff, but they're like local bands that are streaming to like the local fan base. It's nothing. I haven't seen anyone do anything big besides that big Dropkick thing that just happened a little bit ago. But
what are some of the things holding bands back from doing that?
I guess people living in the same place. That's a big thing. At least the Periphery guys all used to live here in DC, and only one guy is left now, and everybody else lives in California, Texas, and New York. So it's like to fly to each other is like a big deal. But I mean, I don't know how many bands even live near each other anymore. It's not like really common.
I don't mean for this to be negative when I'm answering that same question you just asked. I think it's a lot of say you're going to do something, but actually trying to follow through with it is a different thing.
For sure. Yeah. Yeah.
Like it's a lot of that, because I've noticed from what we're doing, I swear to God, I'm not tooting my own horn with this. It's just everything that I actually ever gave a shit about, I just put as much effort into it as I possibly could. That's all with the band. I did that for 9 years full time. I run a clothing company. I've been doing it for, 7 or 8. It doesn't matter. Like 7 or 8 years or whatever. And with this, it's only been 6 weeks, but I've literally, it's all I've done. I haven't turned on my TV since the day I had this idea. I'm not saying that you should or you shouldn't do something a specific way, but like, when the live stream thing, if you're in the same vicinity and you're all cautious of obviously what's going on right now and you're safe about it, why not? Just why not? What else are you doing? Make an effort. That's all I'm trying. Like, anybody can make an effort and use their platform to do something that they want to do.
I agree with that, and I've been thinking about it a lot. Being from Montreal, Montreal's such a hotbed for, there's so many bands from here. So many bands from all genres. So I'm actively thinking of doing this right now. I have my guitarist, Chris Donaldson, who's a producer up here from The Grid. So we are in getting close to what figuring it out how to live stream with perfect sound in a show setting with lights. I want this to happen, and I'm pushing it hard.
I would love to do it. I wish you know, some of the bands that we work for would do it, because that would not only keep us busy, we'd also learn new shit about, like, we don't do much streaming. Like, I mean, I've streamed out of the console into like a fucking 1/8-inch port on my laptop like years ago. But like, you know, I want to do like
any of the streaming I've done has been like external. Like, I've done a couple where there's like Yahoo or something comes in to do it, and they just, I don't even do anything. You know what I mean?
Yeah, like, just left right out.
But it has to be perfect. Especially if you're going to charge for it, it has to be absolutely perfect.
For sure.
Yeah.
That's what I'm dancing around now. And I'm not the technical guy or the sound guy. I just have the idea, and I'm throwing the right people in the room together.
Yeah. I even heard some people talking about, like, okay, so say you live in other states where you could live stream jam. And I was just thinking, like, that just sounds like an absolute nightmare.
That's probably too much delay for that.
Yeah, there's like, how the hell would you ever sync that? Like, it would just find the exact millisecond, you know, and like...
I think Goldfinger has been doing it very well, but I just don't know how. I'm assuming they're all taking their own videos, and then they have a video guy that's syncing it all together. I don't know if you've seen those.
It's gotta be, yeah.
That's what it looked like, yeah. Those videos are awesome. I mean, they're doing great
job. They're, that's they're the only thing that makes very... sense. Very well put together. And I mean, it's Goldfinger. Feldy, they're, you know, the main guy, is like rich beyond his wildest dreams, so he probably has a real pro on the deal, you know.
Rod Diaz from Suicidal Tendencies and Charlie Benante are doing that from Anthrax. They're like, you know, doing that as well, and they're like probably syncing it up at some point. That's pretty cool. Going back to the live stream shows, though, Matt, I was wondering how much, like, is a fair price to charge for a live stream? You know, which is like, you can't be charging like $20 or like.
No.
Like, what do you think is a fair price that like fans would actually pay to sit in their living room for like, you know, an hour and a half or whatever the show is?
But I think it has to be more than a show. It can't just be a show.
Well, yeah.
It has to be an experience. There has to be a backstage hangout afterwards.
Yeah.
Where there's like a Zoom or whatever thing where you can hang out with the band for X number of minutes. You should get a shirt printed in advance that gets shipped to them that they can wear during the show. Lots of logistical shit. But with something like that, with a shirt, with a hangout, you can easily go $20.
Yeah.
But there's a lot that goes into it, right?
Especially with the merch and stuff like that. Yeah, for sure.
That's cool. That's actually a really good idea.
I think people would pay that.
I mean, with all the money that people have been saving not going to concerts, I'm sure like $20 to see one of their favorite bands, you know, like, I mean, I would do it, $20 to watch one of my favorite bands, you know.
And everyone's starving. They're going to be, it's not over anytime soon, so... Even in the fall, you guys are being very optimistic. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, I'm
and
not.
And even the shows that are going to happen, what are they going to look like? Me being a front man.
All I'm thinking of is the first fucking Circle Pit.
I interviewed Randy from Lamb of God, and that's exactly what he said. He said, you know, you can social distance, talk about it as much as you want. As soon as that intro kicks... it's out the window. And
all masks are off, dude. Fuck that.
And then, you know, Live Nation, if they're putting on the show, they're going to be in shit. I don't want to play shows where there's grids on the floor and everyone has to stay in their grid. It's just not something that I would like to do, you know? And then I'm given my all like a normal show, and I look out and everyone's just headbanging in their square. And it's I don't want to play that show.
It's going to give this industry a really hard kick in the ass to find a way to get really creative to make income for not only the bands, but obviously the crew members as well. Because if the bands aren't getting paid the amount of money that they're supposed to be getting paid on a regular ass tour, a regular ass show, then obviously that's going to trickle down to promoters. It's going to trickle down to crew members. It's going to trickle down to everybody involved, managers, agents, etc. Everybody.
Yep. Or the fans will have to pay more.
which is crazy.
You know, especially if social distancing is a thing, let's say you're a 500 cap room, you can only put in 200 people. Yeah, but the band still wants to make their normal money.
I think that a lot of artists coming back are going to have to take immediate pay cuts. I almost think there's no questions asked as far as most artists like
definite pay cuts, but also bands doing more of this residency kind of thing.
Yeah, that's a smart idea.
It'll be like 3 nights in a smaller room. So once they open up, say the caps, you can have 500 people in a room, and a band that'll do a 1,500 cap room easy will do 3 nights in the smaller room, which would be great for all of us.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's honestly, I haven't thought about that. Yeah, that's awesome. Definitely. I'd love to see that.
That's a cool idea.
I have a feeling we'll see a lot of that. Is the bigger bands doing the smaller cap rooms until the capacity opens back up.
Yeah.
There goes all the small bands touring opportunities because that room's booked up for 3 nights.
Well, there's
exactly.
And they can do smaller residencies and coffee houses and shit like that. And the economy's back. There we go.
Open up the mosh pit and the local coffee shop again.
You know that Denny's video all over again.
If you do three shows, hypothetically, like the tour I was about to start was Black Veil Brides and In This Moment, which is, we're not doing anything under like 2,000 cap venues for the most part. If you hypothetically do a 2-night thing there every, you know, or 2 nights in every venue on that tour was a 7-week tour. If we do the entire tour as is, we're staying out there for, a long, long time. But at the same time, are you as busted up? Because the band will be. The crew, not as much. But you get hotel room or whatever, however the situation may be. Obviously, every budget is different. Right. But the band is playing twice as much, which is rough. But the crew is
have to split it up in different legs, you know, like do 3-4 weeks or, you know, whatever, 3 weeks at a time.
Like a little bit longer runs, maybe like till 5 to 6 weeks. And then instead of, I mean, with me and Alex, we're used to like usually like 5 weeks on, 5 weeks off is our average.
Yeah.
And but we would maybe look at like 6 weeks and then like maybe 2 weeks off or something. But you could still go for that. I would definitely be into that. I'm not just for work.
I think anything longer is too devastating on the bands and stuff like that, and they get burnt out real fucking hard. Right. I'm sure. Like 7 weeks is brutal. I mean, I've done it like once.
Oh yeah.
I don't want to. You know, especially on one tour. If I was, obviously, we've all jumped around the time. Like I've done like, you know, 8 months straight, but like all different bands. So at least a little fresh.
But. Yeah, that's totally. I did, I think the longest stretch with Rings, we'd had like 3 months of touring in a row or just a little above. And it was 3 separate, like full tours. And that was a long one. I think that's actually where we met, GJ. It was the Thai Art tour.
Oh, nice.
Where did we meet? We bowled in Detroit, and I remember that was like the first time I met you at the, what's the place called? The Magic Stick or the Majestic Room or whatever?
Oh, yeah, the venue. Yeah. Well, yeah, I remember the bowling room.
Who were you with that day?
I was out with Rings, but we had like 2 days off in Detroit, so we just came out to the show. I think you were mixing Boo? Question mark?
Possibly, yeah.
I think it was that time. I could be wrong. Like Boo Volume.
It was upstairs, right?
Yeah.
Oh, I was covering for Twan. If it was that Boo Volume store. I covered for Twan for like 5 days or something.
Yeah, it was that. It was Boo Volumes. I think. I could be wrong, but I'm like 99% sure.
Switching beers. I'm on to Bar à Bière Maison. This is their Bob, an American pale ale, clocks in at 6%. Nice. Shout out to Bira for hooking me up some brews, for hanging out with you guys tonight, and some of my interviews coming up.
That's awesome.
They just started canning their beers.
Oh, sweet. I noticed you're stepping up the ABV now.
I am. I started with a 4% Pilsner from Abadal 3, now onto this. Luckily, as musicians are suffering and the craft beer industry here in Quebec is being devastated because a lot of the smaller places that don't have distribution or only have beer on taps can't ship to people's houses. So that's something that I've been pushing really hard as well, trying to encourage people to drink local craft beer and try to find a way to keep that small economy going, because I don't want to lose my favorite places in Montreal or Quebec.
Yeah, that's fair enough. Yeah, support as much local business as you can if you must go out. Mr. Kirby, you were on tour and when you got the call as well, right? You were out with Mod Sun.
Yeah, it was actually crazy because I had heard whispers about, you know, certain dates being dropped just because, you know, the ensuing storm. But I was on the phone with Cleveland House of Blues, like their production manager, just confirming catering and such for the show the next day. I got a call on the other line from management telling me that the tour had been pulled. So before the production managers of the venues knew, you know, I was still getting emails 2 weeks after we went home from venues trying to advance. It was crazy. Like, but yeah, March 12th is when it got pulled. We were about a week into a 7-week tour.
Jesus, where were you? Do you remember?
It was in Chicago. I live in Indianapolis, and the night before we were in Indianapolis. So it would have been a lot easier if they would have just pulled the plug the day before. But, but yeah, I was in Chicago when I found out.
We only got two shows in for Killswitch. Jeez. And then the third, we canceled the third one, but
I was fortunate enough to where we were on like the last few shows of the tour I was on. We only had to cancel three, but it canceled our May June tour right off the bat with that.
Directly after the Mod Sun tour, I was going to go out with Amity Affliction. We were going to do the Amity Sleeping with Sirens co-headliner, and that got pulled as well.
Yeah, obviously. Man, it's crazy. Like everything I think all of us had for the year got pulled. And as Alex was mentioning earlier, I've got, you know, like we're starting to get stuff rescheduled for like late fall, you know, pushing towards Christmas. But like, how realistic is it? You know, like I'm not sure.
Yeah, every call that I've been on the past month that every call is a different set of dates, and every time I just tell them, you know, I'm not hoping. My hopes aren't high for anything, you know, this year. I honestly imagine it to not start until next year, the way things are going.
Yeah, I wish that honestly, like, we could somehow maintain some sort of way of not having shows until maybe the beginning of the year next year, if we could do it safely and have it back 100%. You know what I mean? Like, without having to do the trickle system. But I think the trickle system is what's going to have to happen. And you know, like DJ was saying, the 500 cap room three nights in a row. It's a really cool idea that I haven't really thought of.
We'll see. I mean, like those two, I guess Spain and I remember there's one other country in Europe that are trying to start into phase events. And I guess we'll see how that starts. And then I'm sure we'll get
some sort of insight. Because I know Spain was one of the hardest hit places, too, when it was over in Europe.
Yeah.
We almost had to cancel we did cancel our Italy show.
Were you in Europe?
We were overseas when this happened.
I called him. I called him as soon as Trump banned. I called him immediately.
Like,
he was running to the airport trying to get flights home. Yeah, crazy.
Watching all those updates of you guys rushing to the airport and trying to make those flights, I was pretty convinced half of you weren't going to make it.
I was horrified, man, because, like, you know, half the people were like, you do have to be back by this midnight time at a certain time. Then half the people were like, no, you'll be fine. And it's like, I don't like that either way. Like, I just want to get the fuck home at that point. Like, I definitely don't want to be stuck abroad for X amount of time, you know? That's just, like, a kind of horrifying feeling. And then the airport was, like, a 5-6-step safety protocol, like, not just the standard TSA one thing, you know?
Yeah.
I have a friend right now. I had to just double check it before I said the wrong thing. My friend Katie, who was my assistant on the last Andy Black tour, has been in Peru since early March, and she cannot go home.
Damn. Wow. I saw that.
Yeah, she's still there right now. Her and I talked about it the other day because I don't know. She just hit me up asking how I was doing, whatever. And she's stuck in Peru.
That's awful.
Yeah.
I've actually got a friend that lives in Norway, but is currently stuck in Portugal, that can't get back home due to all this.
Yeah, I've got a buddy who lives in, I believe, Switzerland, but he's stuck in Georgia right now. He's been there for over a month.
The country or the state?
No, the state.
Oh, wow. Over by me. Weird.
Yep.
Has anyone picked up any, like, weird hobbies or, like, creative outlets since this has started? I guess, like, Frank, your main source has kind of just been for the Nomads 100%, which is full initiative, and that's really awesome. Which, reminder for anyone watching, if you donate 100% of the donations, straight to For the Nomads.
It is also forthenomads.org if you want to buy anything on there. There's a partner section with a dozen or more different bands and companies that are selling stuff to donate to the fund. We just released a store yesterday, but I'm not actually even promoting it until tomorrow. But there's a store in there. You can get the crazy shirt I'm wearing and several others. There's a lot of ways, but this platform that Alex came up with obviously is one of them. And then forthenomads.org is the website.
Are there other shirts? Could we make like Lighting Daddy or like Front of House Daddy shirts?
Yo, I am completely open to do it.
Yo, I love the Front of House Daddy one.
Dude, that's what I'm saying.
Well,
Monitor Daddy.
Yeah, I have no problem doing it. It's a matter of we're gonna do, I did everything. So I don't even think I talked about that. The whole shirt idea is originally, before we actually launched a store or whatever, it was incentive. It was basically, if you donate $20 or more, we will send you one of these insane t-shirts that we made. And we gave two of them. So if you gave 40, we'll give you both, you know, that kind of thing. So that's why it kind of blew up a little bit, because the shirt is ridiculous. People want it for the shirt. So I have no problem. If you guys want to come up with a design or whatever, we could probably make it work, especially if it's for everybody involved. That's the whole point.
Yeah, I would love to get, but yeah, I'm behind it, whatever I could do, but
Sound
maybe
Daddy.
Just like, yeah, Sound Daddy. That would just cover all grounds.
Yeah. Just give each one of the Nomads their own shirt.
Audio Daddy.
Yeah, Audio Daddy. There we
go. That's something I really did not think about. That's actually, it's a great idea. It's not, I've already noticed with this whole situation, I've only been doing this for 6 weeks. I've been out of the public eye as like an influencer preacher. I'm not in a band anymore, so I don't have to push myself for those kind of things in the last 6 weeks. So now, I've any idea that just seems to kind of people that think I do that's funny or whatever. Like I said, once we hit $40,000 in donations, I'm going to shave a double mohawk into my fucking head. You know what I mean? anything to incentivize the whole situation. So I'll print anything. I don't give a shit. If it makes sense and it works, there's no limits. You know what I mean? That's the whole thing. I don't mind trying, because anything can stick. I didn't think that we would reach $10,000 when I announced it the very first day, and we're at 35 right now. So it's, if you guys want to come up with, if you like that idea and you're willing to push it from your avenues, I will put them up for pre-sale so we can try it out.
Yeah.
I totally back the Audio Daddy shirt.
Yeah. Dude, Lighting Daddy, fucking Video Daddy, dude, you can do them all.
Yeah.
I'm sure people will love that. There's fucking Bobnet has, like, I don't know, 15,000 people. I'm sure people on there would buy some fucking shirts like that.
Oh,
They love fucking funny shit. Like,
I didn't even think about posting it to Bobnet. Yeah, that's great.
I did. Bob is in my corner. He said he'd approve anything that I posted.
That's awesome. But he's a great dude.
Yeah, we had to originally cut our application process only like a week ago, because it was getting out of hand, and we felt it wasn't fair for the people that like wanted to come on board right away.
Yeah, most of those guys are like a team, like fucking arena team.
Yeah,
and I'm sure make a shit ton of money.
Yeah, so we stopped kind of posting in groups, but we came up with a plan. Round one is now done. So everybody, that the 150, it was like 200 people that hit us up. Well, we narrowed it down to like 150 that were actually paying out, because a lot of people do just send over bullshit. If you didn't have the proof, we weren't actually going to accept like what accept the relief program kind of thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Did you see a lot of like crazy submissions, like anything that was blatant bullshit?
Bullshit, no, but like, here's the 3 days out of the 2 months that I had shows canceled. I'm like, listen, dog. I'm like, hey, I just lost 4 months worth of work, and I'm not going to say numbers, but plenty of money. You know what I mean? Like, your three shows, I do feel bad for you because that's probably your job. But like, I got 120 to 150 other people that actually have tours that were absolutely canned. Yeah. So, yeah.
Yeah, that's why I feel like I kind of lucked out with only having three canceled initially, but that it did end up, you know, canceling my May, June, and then now inevitably July, August as well. So we're just kind of
same with us. We'd had March, April, May, and June all canceled. I mean, actually, I don't think the June tour has formally canceled, but they've canceled Download and Grass Pop and
so we're supposed to go to Europe for
We did the same thing in
June. So I don't know. I mean, I know, but
it's not. Yeah, it's not going to happen.
I don't know, but I haven't been told.
But like, you know, a few of the major festivals have canceled already, so it's like there's no point because those are the big guarantees. We only go there for those festivals and play the
right, stars. And then the other shows are just kind of routed around that, you know.
Yeah. So again, that's going to be gone. So yeah, we're up to 4 months now, and
when this is done today, I know Sam is first round one list, right? I believe you were.
I think so.
Yeah. So Sam's on round one, which is over. We reopened up the applications, so round two has already started. Please, anybody here, obviously, just go apply. It's not. I know you guys. I know what you do. It's not a big process. It's just you just got to prove for management, etc. Please apply so we can send you some fucking dough at the end of the month.
Hell yeah! Hell yeah! Thanks, man. Appreciate it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really an awesome, awesome cause. I know I've already said it, but thank you again for doing something like this for the community of, you know, crew members.
Yeah, and everyone should donate everyone. Right now that's listening. Everyone listening, hit that donate button. Let's give some more money for the Nomads.
Everything. I can't stress enough that whether it was when I was a musician or now as a crew member, every, like, 95% of the percent of the good memories that I have in my entire life has been spent on the road with people like this in what I do. Everything that makes me happy in this world has more than likely happened while I was away from my home. So why the hell not try to help people that literally gave me the life that I live? You know what I mean?
How has this affected Cryptopsy, Matt? Have you guys had to cancel any events, or did you have anything lined up?
Cryptopsy is sort of in the writing session right now. When I called you there, when Trump banned international flights, we were in a cabin up north writing the new Cryptopsy record. So we are in like a writing session. We had one fest booked in Winnipeg, and that's it, with Flo being in Ultimas with David Vincent.
Yeah, he was actually over in Europe when I was. I kept seeing the flyers. We were like crossing the same venues.
And Ollie being in Cattle Decap, and they're like just released their record. They had like a whole touring cycle. This whole summer was quiet for us, luckily. So we're just writing and doing like Zoom writing sessions. Chris figured out a way that we can hear exactly what's happening in his studio via Zoom. It's been really cool. It's been fun, and I'm stoked about the new record. But luckily we had nothing. It's like a weird, I was pissed that we had no summer festivals booked, but it sort of worked out for the good.
Yeah,
personally, I've been hunting like crazy and I did 30 interviews in 30 days for Vox and Hops.
Yeah. I was going to say, I've noticed the Thirsty Thursday Zoom hang sesh as well. What do you call it? The after hours or?
No, it's the Thirsty Thursday virtual hangs. Yeah. So it's the seventh week. This is going to be the eighth week. I hang out with people on Zoom. Some Vox and Hops alumni come through, other Vox and Hops heads, which are the listeners, and some of my personal friends show up. Last Thursday, we were 50 people. It was really cool. I've started like a Facebook group through it, and people are like communicating from all over the globe. It's been really, really interesting. But I would have never have done interviews via the internet before. I was always like, let's hang out together. Let's drink a pint. Let's drink a pint together in a craft beer bar. Let's actually connect. Let's get to know people. I've interviewed a lot of the bands that you actually work for. It's something that I love, and I would have never done it this way, but I was super depressed once everything happened because I had so much organized. I was hyping up a whole bunch of after parties because I was sponsoring a tour, Devastation on the Nation. But it all fell through, and I just hit the ground running, and I did like 30 interviews in the past 30 days with some cool people, and it's been going really well. I've been hustling three episodes a week. It's fun, but it takes time.
I noticed the one with Randy Blythe got a lot of Metal Sucks, Metal Injection coverage.
Yes, finally, for fuck's sake. It pisses me off that they don't. I send them stuff every once in a while when I think I got some cool stuff. Like I did Ken Sorcerer on from Abigail Williams, and he told me that he was writing a new record. I released the episode 2 days later. I sent it to everyone. And then a week later, I saw that they shared Blood Music, which is their record label, saying that they're releasing a new record. And I was like, mother, you know? Anyways, it's okay.
Yeah.
We're competing media, but I never see anything as a competition. I see everything as a community that we're uplifting. So whatever.
That's what I'm trying to bring down in my own ego. It's I've sent out hundreds, and when I've sent out so many goddamn emails in the past 5 weeks, way more than I've ever sent as a tour manager, to try to get real world media on for the Nomads. And not once has anybody bit. It's all been within the music industry so far and no one else. So I understand exactly what you're saying. It's like you're trying so hard. But at the same time, there's so much other crazy bullshit going on in the world that why do they look at me? Why would they look at me? So I'm like trying so hard to shove it down to where it's not bothering me. But it actually bums me out every now and again.
It's hard. And then I go and I scroll through these Metal Sucks and Metal Injection. I see what they are posting. I'm like, it's boring.
Yeah, most of that stuff, in my opinion, is clickbait. At least it's Metal Sucks. Maybe I don't really focus on Metal Injection much just because I see more from Metal Sucks. But not saying that one's better than the other. But it just seems like clickbait to me.
You asked if we started any hobbies, and my wife just released a book that I narrated for. It's a children's book called Today We're Staying Home, and it's a book about families coping with social isolation. It came out last Thursday, and it's doing really well. It's a free ebook for download, and I narrated the YouTube in both English and French. So that was something fun to do with, and she worked really hard on it. It's doing really well. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah, you'll have to send me the link to that, and I'll make sure it's in the comments. And
absolutely. Awesome.
Yeah, I would love to send that to my niece and my nephew.
Beautiful.
Hey, you said it's available in French?
Yeah, because we're here in Quebec, so yeah.
Oh, yeah, send me the link, please.
Cool.
Are you trying to learn French?
My sister teaches, ESL. So
what is
that?
So
she teaches English as a second language.
Oh, got you.
So she teaches, but she has a degree in French. So she teaches kindergarten teachers.
Cool.
French and English. So she would love that book. I'll grab that.
And it's warm and fuzzy. It's not anything depressing. It's uplifting, which is exactly what families need right now. Yeah. It's okay. It's okay being at home. It's not easy with kids. I don't know. We were mentioning before we started this, there'll probably be some screaming kids in the background. Social isolation and getting shit done and being a hustler, like you were saying, Frank, and putting everything into something like I have done with Vox and Hops, like my wife did with the book, and still working because I work in early childhood education. I'm working from home doing online training for right now. But getting all of that done, it takes some patience with kids at home. And I love my kids, but I love them a little bit more when they're asleep right now.
How is it just, you know, from a parenting aspect of like with schools being canceled and stuff of that nature? I guess that goes to DJ and Matt. But how are you seeing that?
They're fucking opening schools here next week.
Are they?
Really?
I'm not stoked about it. It's really, really fucked up. I'm really upset about it, actually. They are saying here in Quebec that the people that are catching COVID and are actually getting sick and dying from it are all old people living in old folks' homes, and we call them CHLDs here. So it's like long hospice staying where you end up going to die. Your family can't take you in, you know, situations. So that's where the majority of our deaths in Quebec are coming from. So they've decided they haven't said that it's for the sake of the economy, but it's absolutely for the sake of the economy, to reopen childcare establishments and elementary schools, not CJEPs, colleges, sorry, and high schools are closed until September. But yeah, I got to go back to work in like 2 weeks, and it's going to be madness with social distancing in a childcare establishment. It makes no sense. So apparently there's going to be like at the grocery store. I don't know if it's like that where you guys live, but there's the lines of what direction you can go in certain places and where you have to stand. It's going to be like that in an early childhood education center, and it's going to be really, really messed up. And we can't let them play with half of the toys that they're supposed to be playing with, because it's you can't wash it properly. It all makes sense. We have to disinfect all the toys 3 times a day. It's madness. Oof. It's going to be impossible, A, and it's going to be...
How are you going to keep them from being... Exactly. ...touching each other?
Exactly. It's
like, they're not going to wear masks, are they? I mean, obviously, maybe you guys will.
We have to wear masks and a poncho or something and glasses or something. You know, kids are already a little bit afraid of me because I'm a dude already. The mask is not going to help. I'm not stoked about it. It's really fucked up, and I don't get it. And the government's not saying it's for the economy, but it's absolutely for the economy, so that people can go back to work. Because obviously, teenagers, high school students, can stay home by themselves.
That's crazy. Yeah, but we're not doing any school until next fall. We're canceled through the year, so I just hang out. I'm the teacher now, and I try to find a creative way to teach my son something new every day and try to be patient. I'm learning patience through this more than anyone is learning anything else. I'm learning.
You have to. Yeah, it's you know, and then sometimes we're tired, and because we're hustling on other things late at night, and it's not their fault. It's not their fault you tasted all that beer.
DJ's hustling the garden life right now, right?
Yeah. Hustling in the garden, and then me and the wife do she owns, runs an upcycled frame shop where we take old frames and repaint them and sell them.
Like that beautiful one behind you, only available for $12.99.
Yeah.
Or whatever it is. $20.99.
So we do what we can, but yeah, the time with the kid is pretty awesome. I actually enjoy it at this point. I mean, I would much rather be working, but I really do enjoy it, the time with my son. And I feel like the more time that I have, I become more patient, and I become a better dad, which is pretty cool.
Hell yeah.
I'm
used to being away so much and just missing so much stuff that like every day I get to see all the new things that he does, which is something that I don't get to see on the road besides the other side of a phone, which is nice to have.
How old is he? And Matt, how old are your kids? Oh, wait, no, you
my,
work.
My son's 5.
I have 2 kids. I have a 4-year-old and a 2-year-old.
Got you. Yeah, so they're all around the same general age. Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you think, I guess, another kind of parenting question, because I haven't really had opportunities to ask this. What do like the kids think of it?
It's so hard to explain.
Even able to really comprehend like what's going on?
I'm more worried about what's going to happen after this or the effects of, because now we go out I try to go out for a walk. I live in Montreal, not downtown, but still a lot of people around. And, you know, my daughter rushes away from people now. How long is, you know, this is going to go on for hypothetically 18 months. This is going to be something that's ingrained in her. It's going to be very difficult to once we go back to normal. You know, I'm so used to hugging people and, you know, like I'm a hugger. It's how I am. Is that something that I'm not going to have in me anymore? Are we still going to cheers? But to explain it to a child that you can't be with other children or you can't. They don't get it. It's you know, what is a virus? And I just keep people saying they might be sick. But the worst part is it's that not even them that might be sick. It might be us that's sick, you know? It's crazy.
Right.
Has anyone
super difficult to explain.
Yeah, I can really only imagine. Has anyone actually been formally tested yet?
Not me, no.
Nope.
I haven't been either.
I got hit up the other day. This is something I wanted to talk about. It's a merch company trying to make me make Vox and Hops face masks. And I was like, I don't want to do that. I don't want to make any money off of this fucking virus. I don't see it as a positive thing. I don't know what you guys think about that.
I mean, I've seen a lot of people try to make masks and stuff. I mean, like, you know, like there's actually a backdrop company. I'm not going to name names, but they're a pretty high-end backdrop company that do big arena tour backdrops. And they were selling masks for $25 using their, like, backdrop fabric. And I'm like, that's insane. Like, you can sell – that fabric costs you nothing. You know? Like, that's to make money off people. And then people, like, trying to hoard – you know, they were doing, like, Amazon merchants or whatever. They were hoarding boxes of fucking sanitizer and bleach and all this shit. And they were, like, selling at a huge price.
I do have a few friends who are selling masks, but they're selling them very cheap, and they're they're using all their materials that you know they already had. That's insane.
For a mask that's just fabric, it's not even like an actual respirator mask that has filters. Like I have an N99 and a 95 that I use in my wood shop that ran like for paint and shit. Like I never thought I'd use it for anything else, but like those are the masks that should cost more, and shit, those 3M ones don't even, they're like $10.99 or something.
I was gonna mention too, like with the masks, like are they even like medically clear, you know what I mean, like what is it actually doing any good? You know,
it's just the branding. It's just, you know, it's gonna become mandatory.
I'll send you the link, Alex, in a little bit.
He was telling me it's gonna be mandatory, so it could be a good opportunity, and I don't see it. He said hypothetically we could donate all the proceeds. But me being myself, Vox and Hops, I ship everything. And when I do a ship day, it's a fucking pain in the ass. Yeah. I better make a little bit of dough from it. Because all that packing and everything, it's a pain in the ass.
How is it on your end? Do you do all of your own shipments, Frank? Or do you have like an outsource company?
Yeah, so with my clothing company, I use, both sides of the spectrum for the nomads and then also for Cat. It's outsourcing. I used to do it that way. I used to package all my own stuff, but when I was touring less, when the band was coming to the close, I started the clothing company to essentially just hopefully pay my bills or at least have another batch of income just so I could survive. And that's when I was doing it all by myself because I was able to, because we were slowing down and it's not like we were selling hundreds of orders every week or whatever, but it was enough to sustain me. As time went on and I kept on touring more frequently and for longer and with more bands, I sent it off to different companies. So with For the Nomads, it is a very close booking agent friend of mine who works for a small company who is having trouble in upstate New York. And he's like, hey, I get a kickback for this. I'll design all your shit also, the Merch Daddy shirts and whatever. And then it's kind of like an all-in thing. We'll send everything out for you. We'll print it. I said, okay, good. Just get me pictures of everything. Get me videos of when you're printing and show me I want to see the huge amount of stuff we actually ship to get people excited to want to continue this on. And they've been great to us. He's a very good friend of mine. And he is in the music industry as well.
Sorry. Very nice. Do you want to explain to people what Cat is? Because personally, I love the Cat clothing line. I've been a fan since I figured out.
You have a shirt, don't you?
Yeah, I do. I have it from Texas Independence Fest. I want to say 2015.
Yeah, that's a long time ago. So when I was struggling, I just created that clothing company. It's called Cat Clothing. It's catclothing.net. I just basically grew up in it. And not that, like, I don't love dogs or anything. It's just I only lived with cats until I was 17 when I moved out of my house. And it's just I made a bunch of really funny designs early on that let us grow into doing for the past 7 or 8 years. So it's been cool. It's interesting to see it grow. I still don't understand that industry very much as a clothing brand. So I haven't tried to take it to some massive level or whatever, but We're trying new things. We had a really good month last month, I guess because the stimulus checks or whatever coming in. But like, I don't know what it is. Marketing is not my strong suit. Keeping things creative is more of my strong suit. I would love if you guys know any sweet marketing teams to send them my way.
Oh, man. And the cat, it still stands for cats and tits, correct?
we strived to get...
Tried to get away from it?
Yeah, we tried to get away from it. That was the whole thing. Early on, those are my two favorite things on the planet. So it was easy to just call it that, C-A-T, cats and tits. We've tried to strive away from that because we've done a lot of... We did, just like For the Know, it did way better than I expected it to. So like a year and a half to 2 years in, I kind of stopped putting that kind of content on our socials and on our shirts in general and whatnot. And we've kind of just tried to keep it still funny and slightly edgy just in design work. But yeah, we kind of tried to strive away from that.
Well, good to know, because I definitely got one from the old era. Oh, you did. Yeah. I guess this will be an Alex and Sam question, just audio chat for a sec. What's your favorite console at the moment?
Oof. That's a tough question.
Because I've kind of got like two. It's like I've got a favorite, then I've got like what's tour practical favorite, you know?
Yeah. Sure. For me, the Abbott SXL, I think, is the best of all the worlds. It sounds phenomenal. Best snapshot abilities. But I love the Midas sound, so I'm on the Pro 2, Pro 2C with Killswitch, and me and DJ share a stage rec, so that's cool.
That was literally going to be my same answer. I got to carry an SXL last summer. Also,
it's so sick.
It was incredible.
Sounds so good.
I've only gotten to sit on one maybe four or five times, but it's all been like festival stuff overseas to where I don't really get that long to set up on it.
Yeah. You need that's not a, it's not like a profile. Like a profile is a throw and go console, and like you cannot do that with this console. If you had a previous show file, you still like, sure, things are laid out where they should be or whatever, but like the knobs are different sizes and like it's just a different workflow. So you definitely need a couple of days on it
to get my workflow. My first time on it was surprisingly well, but it took me like 5 minutes to realize where the fuck everything even remotely was. You know,
yeah, it takes a while. So what you can do is build not snapshots, but they're like function keys, and you can pretty much trigger any button to do anything. It's so sick. So if you if you move the fader down, you can have the high end come back up, you know, or like you can automate when you go up, the high end will come back down. It's crazy shit like that. You can automate tap tempo with an incoming click from like the band, you know.
That's sick.
So you don't ever have to tap your delay ever, and it's always going to be perfect. You know, shit like that. But I mean, you can do you can do all kinds of crazy shit. There's the Avid SXL users Facebook group that has just like. Ryan John and Sound by Sully are doing all of these crazy events and stuff like that. So it can get pretty intricate. I love Midas, but
whatever. I'm definitely the most comfortable on a Midas desk.
For sure. I want like an all in one. The SXL preamps for like half of my channels, Midas preamps for another half of my channels, and then like I want like the user flexibility of the SXL and maybe some like Digicode preamp somewhere else in there for like tracks. Yeah. You know, like I want that. I just wish that all the manufacturers use the same fucking language over Ethernet or fiber or BNC or whatever, and I wish it was just all the same so we could just interchange whatever we wanted. Crossplay.
That's the dream. That's the dream.
What's your favorite desk at the moment, DJ? Do you agree? Are you also an SXL fan?
They don't let me play on the SXL, so we own an M32R. So that's my console that I get for Killswitch.
Yeah, but what's your favorite?
What's your favorite to sit down behind? Because, I mean, I still love an M32, but you could sit behind her and have a great show.
Yamaha's, like, the CL, QL series, I would say, for me, is my favorite.
Those are slamming. They're super reliable.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just started picking up on more of those.
Yeah, I
didn't carry a desk with me this last tour to Europe, just specifically because I wanted to, because they always have a fuck ton of those Yamaha QL and see whatever the fuck over there, and just from what I've noticed. And so I wanted to like build a lot more shows on that and just kind of get comfortable with scenes and shit on that.
Do you use a lot of scenes? Anything? Snapshots for
I typically just do scenes because, like, if I take a console out, it'll pretty much just be like an M32 with a DL32 on stage.
Yeah.
And pretty basic setup. And from there, I'll kind of use the same scene almost every day with, you know, obvious room tweaks and shit.
I carried an M32 with me on the last Atreyu tour I did, and that was the first tour I really dove into snapshots. It honestly is sick. I didn't realize how much you can utilize like snapshots per song, and it makes a hell of a difference, especially when you're traveling with the same gear every day.
You can really fine tune and tweak your show like that. I have a couple, but they really just do some panning and some minor volume stuff. But it scares me that it's not going to like update right from the last show I did or something. That's going to sound wrong, and I don't know. Freaks me out. Snapshots freak me out. I just want it to work all the time. Like, I don't want it to ever go wrong. Sure.
I was out with The Word Alive. We were on an In This Moment tour, and Brian Hardwick, he's like a huge snapshot guy. Like,
oh, yeah.
So every day I'd watch him, like, you know, tune and tweak his snapshots. I'm like, dude, I want to learn how to do that. I want to get in on that. So when I finally got the chance to, luckily I had a guitarist who every single song he had a different patch. That was the same, you know. So it was, I could go in and design each snapshot per.
It also depends on the band. Like Periphery, I have way more snapshots because there's three guitar players. I don't have three hands to like automate pans, and everybody plays in the center at a different point. With Killswitch, it's a little easier, but like, it depends on the band, man. I don't think you need to automate a fucking rockabilly band, like, or whatever. Yeah, it really depends, but it's cool. Useful tools.
Yeah, for sure.
You do lights as well, Frank. Yeah. Do you have like a favorite lighting desk that you use? No.
I love doing lights, but it's my least professional thing I know how to do.
Fair enough.
The fact that I get to do it on tours is actually kind of funny to me. but being I can't stress this enough. To anybody who may be a crew member watching or anything like that, just learn a little bit about a lot. I'm not saying suck at all things that you're learning a little bit about, but if you're reliable in what you can accomplish with what you know, then you'll get hired to do more things, or you'll get hired for more artists and able to do so. So when I started just being the crew for my band broke up, I learned a lot of one or two things, tour managing, merchandise, VIP stuff, like the easiest, tour manager, believe me, is not easy, but the most accessible, not having to go and stare at something to kind of understand it, things, those are what I like really honed in on. And then I learned a little bit about everything else from there. And I've done lights for, I tour managed and did lights for Bam Margera for a bit. The Browning was the first band that ever was like, yo, we need somebody to do lights because this guy's a fucking idiot. Oh, okay, I'll do it. Andy Black all last year. Yeah, Andy Black all last year. Black Veil Brides now. There's a laundry list. It's just I learned enough to where I can get by in most situations. And when I do have to take a rig with me, I always go to the guy, whichever company we use, and I sit there and I understand with him. But no, I don't have a preference. I mean, I definitely have a preference because I've used dozens and dozens and dozens of boards all over the damn world. But I can't walk in everyone and know exactly what's going on. I'm not walking up like a complete idiot either. I've done my job to where I can get by with the things that I need to get by with. And when I know the songs for each band that I'm working for, like the back of my hand, like you're supposed to, it shows that like the musician in me comes out because I
think we lost him.
Bam. He just told us the secret.
Probably too. Look better because he's unbelievable pro. But
you're
I
back.
Know
it,
that
it just skipped for like 15 seconds, so you may want to like go back in time.
You were frozen. About me?
Yeah, you were frozen.
Oh. basically, I could get by. But yes, I would recommend learning. I would recommend learning as much as you can, as many different things you can, to open yourself up to new opportunities as a crew member.
What's your favorite of the jobs that you do? So, I mean, you mentioned you did like TM, VIP, merch, and you know whatever. What's the favorite? If you just had to pick one.
I like tour managing because I know it'll be done correctly. But I like the less responsibility of doing merch on a big scale. And when I say less responsibility, I mean I'm not controlling the tour when I'm doing
worrying
merch.
About everybody else.
Yeah. But when I do tour manage on a regular club tour, I know that my scheduling is always going to be super on point. I know that everybody's going to kind of understand where I'm coming from right away because of how I've lined the tour up in general. So I do like take control of a tour in like as a whole, but it has to also be for the right band. I don't just like tour managing every band that I get my hands on. You know what I mean?
I learned it the hard way.
Yeah. To give you an example, I'll just put two out there. I love Andy and I love Black Veil. I would take them a million times over the Yellow Wolf tour that I did for 4 months. You know what I mean? It's just.
Yeah. It's rough. Sam, tell us about learning the hard way.
There's just been plenty of bands that say, oh, you're front of house in TM. You want to double up and combo for us? I'm sure. And then you learn the hard way. You know, like, there are certain TMs meant for certain bands. And the same thing for any crew position.
Yeah.
But, doubling up, you're already taking on a bigger workload. So I've just learned that you shouldn't just jump into running a band's, a whole band's business, without, meeting them in first. Because I've worked with plenty of bands coming in first day of a tour, never met them before. It's like, most of the time it's going great, but there's been a handful of times where, we weren't fans of each other.
Yep.
There's nothing worse than that on the road, you don't want any added tension.
No.
I did four jobs at one time for Amure for 3 or 4 years, but I knew those guys for a long time coming up to that. Basically said right off the bat, I said, you're going to want me to do specific things as a tour manager that I cannot do if I'm doing merch, lights, VIP on top of that. So you just have to make it very clear with your artist on what do they want from you. Okay, I can do that. Or if you want me to do four things like I did for Amure, it's going to eat up my entire day and you're going to get less of a hands-on tour manager, but you're getting more jobs done for my paycheck, which looks great, but less for them in the long run with extra people.
It's like a lot of them for like Hail the Sun on their headliners, I'll TM. On VIP in front of house, and I've got really busy days, and we're so close that like they understand when I'm stretched in, they don't mind jumping in and helping me out. And it always works better when it's a family environment, like majority of tours.
Yeah, totally. I was doing double duty for Rings of Saturn for like 5 years or so, just TMing in front of house. And now that we're able to have another crew member on, we have an awesome TM, Bryce, who double duties merch. But hell, even one tour we did, I had triple duty where I was TMing the headliner, mixing them, and doing merch. So it was just hell, It's
party
like,
there. Come on, brother, party on.
As long as it's not the devil's trifecta, the merch, TM, driving.
That's see, if you're a driver, in my opinion, you're just driver.
Yes.
Yeah. I've literally turned. I've turned down dozens of jobs for that. For that exact reason, refuse to drive on tour. Refuse.
I've done those tours, man. I've done van tours. It was like driving in front of house and fucking. But I was like, I'm not driving ever at night. I'll drive in the fuck. I'll drive all day and then do the show. But I'm not driving ever at night. Fuck that. Getting paid $5 a day for like 3 years, you know?
Yeah, fuck.
I'm not trying to drive anymore.
Yeah.
I'm moving on.
Definitely feel that.
Beer check number three.
Check Whale beer number three from Mabadaw City. This is a New England IPA brewed with galangal, which is, I had to Google it before we started this. It is a like a root, like ginger. It's nice. 5.7%. This is brewed with four, you know, we're all going to be okay. The whole rainbow movement is cool.
Very nice. Is that a local beer up there by you?
It is, of course, yes. I walked there 2 days ago to pick it up. Shout out to Gael for hooking me up with some brews.
Oh, yeah. Amazing. You know what? Since we're talking about beer and Vox and Hops, let's do what I'm going to call Vox and Hops Takeover, where you take over for a couple minutes and you go with some questions. I'm sure you have some in your brain.
I do. I have. I've been holding them back. for Frank and... Having been in a band for so long, I know just me going to shows when I'm not playing and I'm there to interview some friends and I see them up on stage and I get that itch that I would love to be up there and get that crowd adoration, that vibe from the crowd. How do you handle it now without, you know, it's been so many years that you haven't gotten that?
You know, I've done a lot of, just like you said, I've done a lot of interviews just the past couple of weeks, like, promoting the For the Nomads thing, and that's the first time somebody's asked me that, and you're so spot on, because there are certain times where I just want to rip my skin off for not being able to do it, and I play music every now and again now, very kind of few and far between. I got asked to join a band that nobody knows who they are. When I met Alex, I played with that band in Texas. That was 2015. It was called Oath, Bottom of the Barrel. Nobody knew who we were, but it was good enough right away. And I had my expertise, you know what I mean? My connections to get it off the ground quick. But then tours piled up. So I put it to the wayside again, and they hated me for it because that was their first time like actually getting out into the world. So I tried it right away, and I found it was very fun, but I didn't know if I felt like starting from the ground up again. Fast forward this past year, it was coming up on the 15-year anniversary of my band that broke up, The World We Knew, and I said, well, am I gonna do this when I'm in my late 30s, like as a 20-year reunion? I was like, I just don't see it making sense, and God forbid, I was like, what if one of our old members or whatever passes away or anything, just anything. Right. What if I pass away? It'll never happen. So in a test in my brain, I hit up my guitar player and I said, hey, let's re-record some songs, see if I can even sing anymore or scream. You know what I mean? Like if I have it in me to build it back up. And we recorded some stuff. It was fun, great, whatever. And I said, I'll hit up some members. Maybe we can do it before the year is over. So it's at least the 15-year anniversary. And if we like it and we want to keep going as far as like doing some regional shows and not touring, but just there's an outlet and there's fans out there who are on the older side now. And when I say older, I mean in the scene a little older. But we broke up 7 years ago. It's like it'll never be the same what it used to be. We were never a huge band then. We're not going to be a huge band just out of nowhere now. So we did the shows. We did two shows back to back in our hometown. We sold out on both. And I got off stage and I felt relieved that it was over. I loved every second of it. It was incredible. And every person that like I'd ever loved in my hometown and people who traveled from all over the country came, and it was incredible. But I didn't like having to be I did fucking everything for the show. There was a promoter, but I did the show. What I'm getting at here is it was incredible, but I didn't get the itch to be like, I need to do this again as a long-standing thing. When I see certain bands on stage, though, that I do tour with, and I see, I was like, that guy's lazy, or that show could be, could be better. They're not giving they're phoning it in. That's when I get the itch, way more than when I put the show together to play the show. I get the itch on certain people that take it for granted, I guess is what I'm trying to say. And there's no names that need to be added or anything. It's just, there's been times where I've looked at it and I've been sitting at the merch table or sitting side stage or whatever, and just looking and being like, you son of a bitch. So that was good. I never asked me that. Yeah.
I've done a bunch of interviews. I started Vox and Hops, and I want to ask the question that no one asks. Anyone else get the itch that want to jump up there? And how do you guys cope with it?
Well, last year, I actually filled in for one of the support bands on one of our tours, so I got to get back on stage for a few days. It was cool. It's cool, but then again, I don't miss spending money to be on tour like most musicians do. So.
Cut off. To touch on what you were saying, you just said that you filled in for a band, so you got to play for a couple of days. I was tour managing Chelsea Grin a couple of years ago, and we were that Empiricon Festival in Europe with Despised Icon, and there was a couple other bands on it. But my band toured with Despised Icon back in 2010, and we played together as like when we were a local band in 2006. Obviously, they're from Montreal. You're from Montreal. That's why I'm kind of tying this in together. We toured with them. Alex always asked me to do MVP with them back when we were touring together, when I was like in my early 20s. So even as the merch guy and the tour manager on the European tour, Alex was like, come do the fuck. You're with us for 6 weeks. You're going to do the show. And I said, oh, Jesus Christ. So, it's little things like that that kind of like bring you back. You're like, oh, that's really cool. That's really cool. And then you kind of get it out that way.
Yeah, Alex is the best. Absolutely. He's always a business genius. You want a marketing guy? Alex Arian.
Yeah.
100%. He's really smart. Another question I've been asking all of my guests recently that I always wanted to ask and I always forgot to is, what are your hangover cures?
Fortunately for me, I'm on like a 8-week no drinks thing. I'm just kind of doing a brain detox and life
so
body
surprised.
Detox.
Good for you.
Yeah. So I don't have any. So that's my hangover remedy.
I'm kind of in the same boat. I mean, but like water, Gatorade, sleep. You know, the standard. Yeah, smart water. I've been in the same thing. I feel there's no point to drink. It's like expensive, but I'm not getting any enjoyment out of being by myself. So, but I mean, I have wine. I have some fucking White Claws, but that's, you know,
standard issue. A couple White Claws.
Yeah, the claw's the law, dude.
I've never had one.
Yeah.
During quarantine, we've been doing this thing where we play power hours on video chats and Zooms. So, that's the way to, you know, kind of, you know, socialize.
It's the way to get the little bit of party out, you know.
Exactly. But you end up getting like 10 times as drunk, so the hangover the next day is 10 times worse.
Yeah.
I recently bought an espresso machine, and I've been like
nice.
Just really into like just that morning after a latte and like, you know, seltzer water to sober you up.
Yes.
All good answers.
What about you?
Breakfast.
I suffer in silence. Needed breakfast.
So similar to tour.
Yeah, two little kids. You've seen me, Kendrick. You know me. I wake up. I'm hungover. I do my shit. I do sand check. I'm fine. Here at home, I wake up. I take care of the kids. They didn't drink all the beers the night before. I did.
Yep. That's the only way to look at it. What is your next Fox and Hops coming out, the episode?
Tomorrow I have... Giorgio Spevo, who is the owner of Everlasting Spew Records. I've been doing a spotlight on Everlasting Spew Records episodes, so one episode every week. I play a track from one of their bands. It's been really cool. I've been really enjoying it, so I just sat down. like this with Giorgio last week, who lives in Italy. Very cool chat. That comes out tomorrow. Yeah.
That's awesome. It's good to see you still being, you know, busy with the outlet. I certainly didn't think that you would take it to the internet either when we were sitting in the wagon whatever day we did ours.
No, but I would have never done it. The connections, I didn't imagine the connection would be there, and we had to share the same beer in my mind. It was all about that. But I
certainly
become creative during these crazy times.
I want to say that during the episode, it's like where we coined the phrase. Maybe it wasn't during, maybe it was right before, but when in doubt, one more stout, you know.
it became a shirt. Yeah, I have all these shirt ideas, which I'm just not making them anymore because I feel that people don't have any money. So I'm just going to take it easy for shirts for a while.
It's a tough business right now.
Yeah, I'm just going to take it easy. I got a bunch of ideas. I always create evergreen content. I always ask questions that are not time-based, unless I hit up some publicists too recently to try to get some interviews, and I had to ask more like time-based questions about the albums that they're dropping, which forced me to release certain episodes on certain days, which is fun and it's a good challenge to get them out quicker. But I rather ask like evergreen content, come up with evergreen t-shirts where it's always just, it could be fresh in a month or tomorrow, you know?
Yeah, certainly. Let's see, TJ, how is it down in, you're in Austin, correct? How is it down there during all this madness? I know that's usually a pretty lively city.
It's hot.
Yeah.
Everybody seems to be playing ball pretty good. It's a music city though, so we're kind of waiting for things to get back to normal, and it's going to be a long time.
Is like Sixth Street, is stuff opening up yet or no?
I believe they open certain businesses on the 1st, and then other ones will open on the 18th.
But I don't
think there's going to be any like bars or venues open at that point. I'm not positive, but
right. One thing I noticed.
Clubs that I'm going to be working at aren't going to be opening for any time soon. So.
Yeah, certainly. I was doing some work in between tours out in Los Angeles at a venue, and they're not looking like they're going to be doing any shows anytime soon. So, and in where I am now in Georgia, the whole state just opened up this previous Monday. So, like this past weekend, there's a bar like a mile and a half from my house that was packed, hundreds of people.
Right.
It's insane. Jesus, I didn't go. Christ. I drove by, but yeah.
Isn't it such that the reason why we're all so fucked is because of other people?
Yes.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. Exactly. Sorry. To change my entire career because you're an idiot.
Yeah. It's, you know, and I don't know about you guys, but I didn't really think pandemic when I thought about going into the music industry.
Yeah.
No, not at all.
This has been one that I've wanted to ask forever. Sam, feel free not to answer. What was your biggest show disaster working at the ever so famous, infamous Emerson Theater?
There it is.
Let's hear it.
Okay. Is it for Sam or is Sam not going to answer this?
I've got more than you can ever imagine. I worked there for 7 years, so. Well, go ahead, Frank. I want to hear yours.
I don't know if it's not a disaster by any means, but I was very much approached at the ATM right next door at the bank, and somebody wanted to sell me what looked like an iPhone, correct? Like an iPhone. This is years ago. So whatever the earlier. Maybe an iPhone 2 or 3 or something like that. And I said, oh, that's pretty cool. And he clicks it and it's a fucking taser. So not only am I trying to go to the ATM at the bank right there, but the dude has a fucking taser that I don't know if he's going to use on me or try to sell. And he tried to sell it to me.
You know, what's funny about that is I know exactly who you're talking about, and I have bought one of those tasers from him before. I swear. I work at the bar. I bartend at the bar that's attached to Emerson, and he comes
shout
in
out
like
once
every 2 or 3 weeks, and Jay Clyde's pub, baby. He brings in a box of random things like tasers and knives and just tries to sell them.
I regret
East Side Indianapolis stuff.
Yeah, I regret not buying one, to be honest with you.
Oh, they're pretty sick.
I am curious to hear your experience, Sam, just by spending so much time there. Like, is there one that sticks out? Because I loved all the staff. The venue was always meant well, but there just always seemed to be something wrong audio-wise.
Yeah.
You know?
I think the worst time I had was actually a few weeks after Summer Slaughter. What was that, 17? 16 or 17? You were out with Rings. I was out with Donny Fetus.
So 17.
So blacked out. It was on Slaughter. And a few weeks after Summer Slaughter ended, they were coming through on a one-off at the Emerson. Mm-hmm. I had just got home from Slaughter. I go into the venue and realize whoever was front of house while I was at was gone, had somehow just blown up every power amp. So we had to reinstall power amps, and then we realized half the cones are blown out, subs were blown out. It was just everything was just destroyed. So me and three guys stayed there overnight, worked all through the night, and Black Eye got there at noon for the load-in. They walk in, and they're like, you guys okay? Like, you look kind of shot right now. I told them what happened. They're like, okay. Go for a sound check. Nothing works. Marshall was with them at the time.
Oh, okay.
So we had to bring in a whole new PA 2 hours before doors. We finally got it. Seemed fine. And then the bad power in the building in the middle of their set blew up the other amps we brought in, so they had to end their set.
Yeah, the power. That's what it is. The power.
It was always a power issue.
Yep.
But while I was out with Mod Sun, they actually reopened the Emerson. Someone put in about $500,000.
Is it at the same location?
Remodeled it. Same location. New PA. Aesthetically, is completely different. It actually looks clean. It's kind of crazy. But
wow.
They reinstalled, like, they had all new power ran from all new sources. So we'll see if the new management can, once venues reopen, can keep it afloat and it becomes a good venue. But honestly, my experience with Mod Sun while I was there, I had a decent time. Nothing went wrong. Because I'd been through there with plenty of other tours, and something would always go wrong. And of course, it was my hometown that it would happen in. But, you know, that show was fun, so you know the new guys might have something going for them.
What was it that they finally started selling beer there, right? Because I remember it was a dry venue for the longest.
Yeah, well, we actually, when I was working there, I believe it was like 2.5 years ago, we got the beer permit. So it's not dry anymore.
Well, that's good for those patrons that would like to go to the bar.
I'm just thinking of Emerson Theater now. On that Despised Icon tour that I told you I did in like 2000, I guess it's 2010 or 2011, whatever. And you might know this, Sam. I don't know if you're a football guy. I'm not. But the year the Colts were in the Super Bowl and lost. Do you know?
I'm not sure.
Whatever year that was, we played there 3 days after they lost, and I was on stage, and I threw out a mosh call, something along the lines of "You better lose your shit, just like the Colts." And I heard a lot of like you know the claps that happen right before breakdowns. Heard a lot of come on. It was top notch.
Amazing. Alex and DJ, have you guys had any crazy venue encounters together on the negative side? Crazy amps, mispatches, et cetera, just something fucked?
Nothing that's been outside of our own doing.
Yeah.
yeah.
Fuck, I'm trying to remember this one. I was on the Killthrax tour. DJ wasn't on this one, but like it was, I can't remember what the fuck it was. I have to call.
Feel free not to mention the place and blah blah blah.
Fuck them, whatever.
Yeah, I mean, that's fine too.
It's just like the worst PA I've ever heard, and it was like a legitimate line array that was just set up completely fucking terribly, and like the guy was like, "There's something wrong with it." I'm just like, clearly you can't hear anything. Because it sounds
just like completely out of phase and shit.
I'm like, I was like, I don't know, maybe I'm sick. I'll just, you know. So I called like three other sound guys. I'd be like, please take a listen to this. Does this sound okay? And they're like, no. All right. But I mean, like, man, there we've had a ton over the years, you know, in different venues. I'm sure DJ has too. But like, fuck, I've rehired PAs. I would say more so in the 700 and below range.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah,
you know,
I wish I could count the amount of like NL4s that I've had to, you know, remake.
God damn, fuck, you know, god damn eBay. I've seen a lot of eBay cable. You know, it's that stupid company, whatever it is, they sell. Everybody buys because you can buy like 400 XLR for $20. You know, or something.
It's disgusting.
but. Hey, I got a question for you, Alex Kendrick.
Yes, sir.
Over under or over over?
I'm an over under guy. Just gonna be honest.
That's good. Well, good. It's fine. Yeah.
I mean, is anyone an over over guy really?
I mean, there are some people. You know, it depends on the cable, right?
I swear to God, I thought you guys were talking about eggs for a second. I swear to God.
I'm sorry, we went into audio talk for a second.
In my brain, I said, "What's over?"
Yeah. Scrambled or
grab the cable? You know, I don't think I have one. I got some.
So now you know. Now you just know that I'm a complete fucking idiot. So
boom. So that's how you would do the over under.
Yeah. What the kid should do an over over. How this like a. I know it's easy both ways, whatever. Depends, but for the sake of everybody else, over under. Isn't everybody?
Yeah.
Look, man, we all went to school to learn engineering and ended up becoming professional cable wrappers, which is all we do. Any corporate show that I've ever done has been miles of fucking.
Oh, yeah, certainly. Table. And then even working in the venue in LA, like most of the artists that we have their own front of house, so I'm literally just.
Fucking babysitter. That's why I don't want to work in a venue, and like that's why we like have to tour, because like I want to mix. Like I don't want to go to I love money. Who doesn't? But like I don't want to go to a fucking venue. Like I work at Ram's Head and Fillmore and Silver Spring, and it's like you just go in there and everyone has their own guy, so you're just sitting there jerking off, like doing nothing. But it's like, oh, but you can mix the opening band. It's, yeah, but the opening band sucks, and their gear sucks. All their shit sounds terrible, and you can't like have them change it. You know,
like the Line 6 extreme metal tone.
Oh, dude, it's like a fucking HM2 going in an HM2. Like those like fucking distortion pedals, Metal Zone boss pedal or whatever. That's just all it sounds. It sounds horrible, and it's just like that's not a pleasure to mix. It's a pleasure to build, like. The sound over the years. Like I did that with Periphery. Like we started out and it was just amps and cabs, and then we moved into different types of tones, and like do that with Killswitch too. I've like learned how to really use a Kemper and use a second one for my own tones, because I don't want to hear theirs because it's not that good.
Yeah. Stupidest shit.
So that's cool. So you're mixing from tones that you make yourself, and then but they're still playing to theirs.
Actually Wes Houck made this tone for me. But I tweaked it just so it could sound just, you know, a little bit better come in and a little flatter coming into me. But thanks, Wes. I don't know. He's not watching. He doesn't care. But thank you, Wes.
Little do we know, Wes is the only person watching.
Yes. Is he? That would be awesome.
No, I have no idea. So I guess on more of a positive side, really quick, what are one of the like more fun shows that you could think of? Is there one that just like sticks out in your brain? This is going to everyone, Matt and Frank as well. One show in your life that just really sticks out, or one of those kind of like, oh shit, you know, I'm doing what I want to do kind of moments.
Brixton Academy with Killswitch Engage just recently. It was fucking basically sold out, and it was like the fucking, the crowd was louder than the band, and it's fucking loud in there already. So it was, I think that was one of my most favorite and most memorable shows, for sure.
How about you, DJ?
I don't get to hear the crowd, so.
So sad.
Okay, what venue had the best cater?
Where I'm able to set up my
show. Well, I mean, you've done front of house for tourists. That's how we met. You know, like if you got like a super fun front of house. You know, like what's one of the more fun shows you've done front of house for or something?
Probably when we did the Killswitch Parkway Drive Thy Art Is Murder run. And I got to do front of house for Thy Art Is Murder. And Sydney was probably the best show.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That was crazy tour, man.
Because the PA was slamming. It was, like, just out on the waterfront. And there was, like, not during our set, but, like, later on there was, like, fireworks and shit. It was magical.
Yeah.
So, that's awesome.
I think that was Brisbane.
That was Sydney.
That was Sydney? The outdoor one?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, okay.
How about you, Matt? What was, like, do you have, like, a defining moment on stage that you could think of where you kind of thought to yourself, you know, like, you're finally doing something that you wanted to do and you're, like, you're successful at it and et cetera, et cetera?
I think you mixed it.
Which one? Was it the Death Fest?
Maryland Death Fest, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
I've
done three Death Fests, so they were fucking awesome.
I've had like amazing. A strange time being in Cryptopsy. It took a lot of time for the fans to come around to me after the Unspoken King and going through some stuff. And I always saw Maryland Death Fest as being like a make it or break it moment. And that crowd was insane. And we did None So Vile in its entirety. It was amazing. We sold
so sick,
so much merch that it was crazy. It was like the third or fourth day of the tour. So we had all the stock that we needed. It was but it was fun and it was great. And funnily enough, like I was a hockey fan because I didn't have a podcast at the time, and I had time to watch hockey. And I think Ottawa was in the playoffs against someone. I can't remember the game exactly. And we were like watching it backstage, and I was like, if it was the Canadians, and they were going into like triple overtime, I was like, if it was the Canadians, I don't know if I'd go on stage. But climb up on stage, and the crowd was insane. And I spoke about it today. Emily Harris,
fun shows.
Emily Harris, a photographer, shout out. She just posted pictures today of it. I was like, that's one of my favorite shows ever. Yeah, so absolutely that one.
Yeah, I think that's honestly one of my favorite shows I've mixed too, because I've mixed in soundstage countless times, but nonetheless, for it to be Death Fest, no barricade, and just us being there so early, like done with sound check by like 11 a.m., just going back to bed to wake up at like 9 or something, you know.
And we partied hard after. It was fun.
Oh, we certainly did. And it was really nice because just naturally going from an empty room to a full room is sonically very different. You know, it'll fill in when the people get here, you know, whatever. It was like really, really drastic that day, I remember. So I was like really pleased with mixing Decrepit Birth right before you guys to kind of like lock everything in the trouble areas. Sam, your turn.
That's a hard question. I think really like one of the, I'd have to say, so I recently did a Scaring Kids did a 10-year reunion tour. And every single show on that tour was, it was crazy, like, because there was just so much emotion going into each show. Obviously their vocalist had passed, so it's kind of a memorial to him. So like his hometown show, they brought his family on stage, and like just the room was crazy. I've never experienced anything like that. Even going into that tour, I didn't realize what kind of tour I was walking into. I figured it'd be 100 to 200 heads, you know, in each show, because I didn't realize that they were actually a big band. We ended up doing almost 1,000 kids a night over some of these clubs. It was just a phenomenal 2 weeks.
That's awesome.
It was crazy.
It's always nice to get something like that, because every now and again you'll get kind of comfortable, and then you'll just be like, oh, this is kind of shot for a second. Or maybe not everyone, but me in my brain, I'll get super comfortable, makes it forever, blah blah blah, and just like, maybe this is kind of shot. But then you get the, you know, the super big impactful stuff that reminds you of why you're there in the first place.
Exactly, yeah.
How about you, Frank? Are you know, playing or crew side? You know,
what? Ironically, this is both playing, but one wasn't my own band, and I'll get to that. I already kind of talked about the 15-year anniversary shows a little earlier on, so I don't need to get deep into that one. I'll get more of the story side of the other one, but it's the best weekend I think I've ever had as a musician in my life, even after not being in a band for 7 years. You know what I mean? Like I said, everybody that I've ever loved was there, and it was just an incredible feeling. So that was great. Good show. Good two shows. They're both sold out. It was wonderful. Anyway, this kind of ties into the whole existence of the For the Nomads thing and also the Merch Daddy design in a way. When I was tour managing Yellow Wolf, the DJ for Yellow Wolf is a felon and he can't go to certain places, and he's actually wanted in, or was, this was a couple of years ago, was wanted in El Paso, I think. Yeah, exactly. Quote, unquote. So we were playing Canada on that tour, and then we were doing Australia and New Zealand, and I was production manager and tour manager on that tour. So they asked me, you know, I would set up the whole rig, the whole DJ rig. They taught me how to do it and this, that, the other thing, because I've never worked with anything DJ related until that moment. And I would sound check for them every day, not scratching and whatnot, but I'd set up the whole rig and like hit the cues on certain songs and whatever. I just knew how to set it up. So go to Canada and they're like, well, you probably can't go because there's always the chance of you getting arrested at the border because you're wanted somewhere, and then they're going to ship you to where that place is. Long story short, they asked me to DJ with a fucking ski mask on, which is what that is.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So I've never DJed before a day in my life. I had no idea what I was doing, but I'm a musician, so I know timings and I know where the cues were supposed to hit, because we were on that time. We were already like 3 or 4 weeks into the tour. So I learned the songs. I know them off the top of my head. I already know how to run the program. All I have to do is stand up there with a ski mask on, be somewhat entertaining looking, and hit the cues at the right time. So my story here is they give me a 1-hour crash course before we go to the border in a taco shop on how to do the set. And I took notes on my set list and everything, what to make, like not only the cues, but just how to hit whatever they want during the set that they've created for the whole tour. So crash course, he's gone. We're in Canada. I'm sitting in the dressing room listening to these songs on repeat, studying my notes on the set list. And then they throw me up on stage in a fucking ski mask, and I start the set in front of 2,000 people in Canada, literally not knowing a single thing of what I'm doing. And people are just like, yeah, yeah. And I'm sitting there going, what am I got myself into? Yeah. And they called me Frankie Fingers for the one finger that I used to press play on every song.
That's amazing.
And that's
I think I might have actually been on tour with that DJ with Yellow Wolf's other DJ. I'm pretty sure I was just on tour with him with Modson.
Was it DJ Clever?
No, his name is Richie. He said he was on that Yellow Wolf tour with you though. I'm gonna give him a call after this.
I don't know, but if it's not DJ Clever, it's not who I'm talking about. It's not who I replaced for Canada, Australia, and New Zealand.
Wow, that's pretty cool, though. I mean, that's that. I don't know. I probably would just be shitting myself. I don't know how to do any of that. Like, I just learned how to set up CDJs, which they're easy. They speak for themselves, but I just never really ever seen them or touched them. You know,
it was very. It was very challenging. It was challenging to do everything right, not because it was a hard thing to do, but because he specifically is a very, very particular person. And if you do something wrong, whatever it is, whether it's me, somebody in his band at the time or anything, it's like the look of pure evil would grace his face. And you're just like, ugh! And I was like, dude, I don't know what the fuck I'm doing. Why am I doing this? But you make it through. And I made more money because of it. And it was fun. I made a thing out of it. I would jump on top of the fucking booth and like just literally flip people off in the crowd the whole set. knows, you don't know who I am, and he doesn't care. He like literally just wants, he's a psycho. So he would just let me do whatever I wanted. I would fucking do front flips off the stage. I got the fans in Australia to bring me a boogie board, and I would boogie board on top of fans with a ski mask on. Like, I didn't care.
That's awesome.
That's awesome, dude. Yeah. It's crazy when you get those crew opportunities where someone calls and you're just able to fill the shoots, you know?
Yeah.
I guess we're nearing towards the end now. I want to ask just if you want to tell anyone or any of the viewers, what's, you know, your most positive outlook on this whole situation, and, you know, what kind of words of wisdom would you share with whoever may be watching? We can start with anybody. Okay, Matt.
Okay. Everyone should donate some money to for the Nomads. Help out the crew members for sure. There'd be no shows without them. They're the people that are the bones of the skeleton of a show. And I'm thankful for having crew members when I'm up there. So everyone should support that. I think that everyone should also be taking this time at home to do these creative projects that have been on the back burner. Use the hustle. Don't just languish. Work out. Get out there. Just use this time creatively, because who knows when we'll ever have a moment like this in our lives again. Where we can
learn everything. Fucking yeah. Learn everything. I'm doing a bunch of courses and crazy shit and doing in Cisco certification, which is fucking hard, but it's keeping me busy. I'm doing a science of diving certification. It's like, I feel like everyone should just learn shit. You have no fucking excuse to not do anything. I just built a bunch of shit too. I built a fucking three tables. I mean, they're like at 2x6s and 1x6s, not like big tables, but like, still,
it's not like Netflix is offering us anything good, you know. It looks like the fucking Tiger King became a fucking sensation because of this pandemic.
Damn it, this is actually my first episode,
and I fucking won't, and I still won't.
This is my first episode of the show not having tigers right here. It's usually some tigers.
That's
right,
fine.
There.
Alex brought a tiger for everyone.
$2,000.
There it is. Yeah, my advice is for everyone is to build a sex wall like Alex, and just to be kind to people, and also vacuum your sex wall.
Yes, I'm actually going to tonight. I'll tell you how it goes.
He charged his Dyson.
I thought about it, but like, why wouldn't I do that? I should do that.
We'll have to do like a follow-up video of that. You'll have to send it to us.
I'll do a GoPro time lapse or whatever and send it to you. We can put it in the comments.
Amazing. How about you, Sam?
I mean, I gotta agree with Alex. You know, stay busy, keep learning. I recently just started getting back into drums, so you know, I thought I'd just annoy my neighbors every day with loud music. So I'm spending my time, but you know, just focusing on myself and stuff that I haven't had the time to do the past couple of years, you know, because I'm constantly on the road. And now that I have the chance to just be home, I'm just trying to utilize it for myself.
A lot of these bigger engineers are doing big podcasts, like, you know, Pooch from Iron Maiden's doing. He says he's done like 10 in the last like 2 weeks or something like that. I've been listening to a bunch of those. I just did one with this guy, Steve. And Pooch is on there, front of house from Steel Panthers on there, and like a bunch of us. So it's cool to like listen to everybody talking, and it's cool to like just not even have audio guys in here, like two guys from bands or like some guy that does something else. It's like, it's cool for everyone to learn from everything. And I agree what you said, fucking, I do learn every job. Like, I've done every job too. It's like,
yeah, it's really resourceful in my opinion to work as a multi-tool as a crew member, to where you can kind of, granted, it may not be in your pay grade or your job, but there may be something you need to accomplish and it needs to be done efficiently and only you know how to do it.
I hate those guys. Oh, that's above my pay grade. It's like,
yeah, so
it's not about you. It's about the show. Okay, the show must go on regardless of how you feel about what you're getting paid to do.
Right.
Like, I can't afford those guys.
Yeah. Yeah. All of us put in like our work, and we all fucking do everything together. You know, we're not, no, none of us are afraid to get our
exactly hands. Just other pieces of the puzzle, you know, you just have to make sure everyone fits in right and knows where to go,
especially like on our level, you know, between the 800 to 2000 cap, that's, we're all like multi multi-hat, you know, jobs, stuff like that. I mean, once you get above that, then yeah, sure, you have just the one guy that's doing the one job or whatever. So.
Yeah, certainly. But in our demographic of shows, there's a certain, or certainly a lot of, you know, double dipping with jobs, which is like necessary.
I've doubled and triple dipped many, many times.
Certainly, like, certainly. And then, you know, it's a way to make more money as a crew member, and it's a way for the band to save money, not bringing someone else on. So, I mean, it does help both parties.
Yeah. I mean, mental health wise, like I remember doing all three bands. It was like the Periphery, Veil, and Good Tiger. It was like a European tour, but I literally did all three bands sound checked. Like I had 1 hour a day to do, like to shout.
Yeah, that's kind of how this past tour overseas was for me. I was mixing the first brutal, and second yeah. band on the tour, and then fortunately I had a break during direct support, and then I could, you know, rest and let my ears not hear cymbals for a little bit.
Oh fuck, I wore earplugs half of it, half of it. He said, "I was like, I'm not. This isn't worth."
Yeah, I mean, it's very vital to keep your ears safe. You know, I mean, yeah, we're working at dangerous levels every day. So
yeah, I'll mix the first three songs and then put my ears in. Cool, that's
exactly.
Especially, but yeah. I'll never fucking do back to back bands or more than two. So
yeah, I'm
for sure.
Right. Yeah, I think two is about my limit now. But for example, like this last tour, I had done the three on the U.S. tour, and then we were just doing the same tour in Europe. So I figured for the workflow, mine as well. And it never hurts the wallet. But yeah, ear protection is a freaking must for anyone working any job at concerts, in my opinion. Frank, any positivity words here? What you know at the end?
We're all gonna die. No. yeah, I mean, what I've been learning from what we're doing with Nomads is strictly everybody has a reach to somebody else. You know what I mean? Everybody can use their outlet, whatever it may be, to reach other people. And it's just, I think I probably said it earlier because I've been saying a lot within these the interviews and whatnot that I've been doing about this is you just never know who's watching out there. You never know who may have a couple of dollars to spare or just has an older older retired dad or something that used to play in a band and just loves the concept of what we're doing here. And even it doesn't even have to deal with For the Nomads at all. Just in general, if you're trying to push something good or you're trying to do good yourself, just use what you have to make light of it. That's all it is. It's if you want to start a podcast like you're doing, it's why not try? Just try using whatever it is that makes you happy for a good reason. And flow it the best you can. And so far, in my estimation, and what I've done has worked. Will it work for you? Maybe not. But if you don't try it, if you don't fucking shoot the three pointer, you're never gonna hit the rim. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
it's basically it.
Yeah, you're not wrong. Well, I want to thank all you guys for being on the show today. You know, that was just 2 hours out of your day that you certainly could have spent doing anything else. So thank you guys very much for being here. And maybe I'd like to think that a few people learned something new about the crew side of the touring world and what goes into it. There's a lot we didn't touch, but there's a lot that we did. So
it's hard to explain without them actually being there. It's hard to explain to someone like what all of us go through like on a yearly basis. You know, it's not just like, you get to like tour the world. And it's like, motherfucker, I haven't seen a city in the last like 3 years.
It's like, we're loading into Prague, but I have no idea how it is. You know,
I know that this venue is sick and the bathroom's like sort of clean.
Yeah. The Viper Room's amazing.
Oh yeah, over in Vienna.
Yeah.
Fun fact, we actually played the last show there before the ban, because they didn't let us load in when we showed up that day, because they didn't know if they were going to be able to let us play because of the ban in Austria when all this started.
Where was it?
Vienna, Austria, a venue called the Viper Room.
Oh, shit. Oh, I thought you meant the Viper Room in, like, L.A.
Oh, no, overseas.
Okay.
No, not the L.A. one. Good God.
No, it sucks.
The Vienna Viper Room.
There's 900 stairs downstairs in the dark, and they're half broken. It's a trip.
It's pretty rough, and there's usually lots of smoking inside. It's like a disaster, regardless of what you advance.
Yeah, oh, yeah, no, they don't care.
But I've had good shows there. I've had fun there.
Oh yeah, I've definitely had great times there. But there's always ups and downs to everything. So, but yeah, that about does it for the time being. We could all continue to FaceTime and hang out if we'd like. But I am. Yeah, I think I'd rather go try and figure out how to make my sexy wall kind of like yours. So,
just find an old zebra rug and hang it up. Screw it into the wall.
That's old. That's just cum socks, dude.
It's not crusty.
You ever feel bad for bus drivers at the end of the tour, or like whoever cleans the bus, and like, well, I wonder why this sock is just here.
The bus vipers.
Bus vipers.
You know, actually, I rode one of my buses back last summer to one of the warehouses and watched the driver just find the most disgusting things, and he's like, "Oh, this isn't even like half of what I normally see." He had a he had a pile of fingernails. He was like, "Yeah, I'd like to just sweep everything into its own pile." Oh, you bus drivers are weird.
who has ridden with as you were doing merch, Daddy? Who has had bus Daddy? No one knows bus Daddy.
No,
someone should be bus Daddy.
Oh, no, there's a guy. He's bus daddy. He's fucking awesome.
We should find a stagehand, too, whose name we can call him Hand Daddy.
Hand Daddy. This is getting out of control, dude. We're going to have so many daddy shirts.
Yeah.
I'm
we'll okay.
See.
For anyone that's stuck around this long, please visit forthenomads.org, if I said that right.
Yes.
Donate there. If you're watching the stream, you can donate directly here. 100% of the proceeds will go directly to For the Nomads. I'm going to leave that up until midnight, so if you're watching this later, it is still relevant and applicable. So that being said, go ahead, Frank.
Oh, yeah. I didn't think this would pop off like it did, so I literally just made an Instagram for it like 3 or 4 days ago. So that's all a lot of people don't go to websites anymore. So we made the Instagram. It's For the Nomads on Instagram. That's all the immediate updates. The store up there is up now. We just launched that yesterday or 2 days ago. So if you don't want to just donate, you could always get something out of it. There's a bunch of shirts on there. And like I said earlier, there's a partnership page on there for any company, Matt, like yourself. Please, if you said that you're already like launched, if you already launched a bunch of episodes and you talked about this already, send me the episodes. We'll put you on the partners in the press page so people can find it. There's a bunch of partners on there that are donating their proceeds from the stuff that they're selling to us. So if you don't like the stupid merch daddy shirts we came up with, you can easily buy something else that still donates to the cause. Or if you got a couple of bucks, send it over. If you can, $5, literally anything, a cup of coffee is the same price. Could really help a lot of different people. There's give or take 150 to 200 different people on board right now that are getting paid out. All crew members of people that probably work for your favorite bands. I'm one of them. There's people in this chat right now. Sam is one of them. I hope everybody else will apply for round two as soon as we're done with this conversation. Yeah, what else? What else? What else? Really just, I can't stress enough how easy it is just to share this to new eyes. It costs $0 to do so. So I appreciate you having me on to even talk about it. It's forthenomads.org. So thanks, man.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you guys all for being on and spreading the word.
Oh, yeah.
And can't wait to see you guys on the road sometime soon. And I'm sure we'll talk before that.
Oh, yes.
Awesome. Thanks, guys.
See you guys.
Bye.